The Love of the Game, Parenthood, Sport and Me. Written and read by me, Mark Chapman. And this book is for my family. Acknowledgements. Well, my first thanks should go to David Phillips and Tim Edwards, my agents at James Grant, who had been suggesting this would make a good subject for a book for at least 2 years before I got round to writing it. Maybe they were just bored of hearing about another Chapman family sporting weekend and hoped that if I committed it to print, it would give their ears a rest. Thank you to Rory Scar for then setting the wheels in motion and holding my hand throughout the whole process. Alex Maguire had the unenviable role of trying to organise that process, so thank you too for being, well, organised. Thank you to Alan Sampson at Orion for liking the idea and being so enthusiastic at that first meeting. Thank you to Lucinda McNeil for patiently editing the book and making sense of some of the nonsense I have written. And thank you to everyone at Orion who helped publicise and market the book. And finally, without sounding like an Oscar winner, my greatest thanks are reserved for my family and friends, many of whom appear on these pages. Mike, thank you for your contribution to this book. It matters so much that you took the time to write that section. Boney, thanks for being a great friend. I'm less grateful for having to play on the same team as you for so many years. And thank you to all those teammates over the years who have had to put up with me. And then to Mum and Dad, Sarah, Ben, Jesse and Millie, I hope this won't embarrass you now or in the future. Everything is done out of love, even though sometimes I may not show it. Prologue. The bat I am holding is beautiful. Just beautiful. I have kept and cherished it for 20 years. It still retains a lovely golden hue, so I obviously applied the linseed oil correctly when I was 17. The back of the bat has two hollowed out strips that are painted red. If a bat was manufactured this way now, the marketing blurb would probably have us believe that this was to make it more aerodynamic and allow the ball to travel further. But back in 1990, such nonsense didn't exist, so it was probably done just to make it look nice. Down the splice is a thick red stripe. Now, bat aficionados will immediately recognise, even from this very limited description, that the bat in question is a Gray Nichols. While my teammates were choosing Duncan Fernley's because that was the bat Ian Botham used, or Surridge's because Graham Gooch destroyed attack after attack with one of those, I went for Gray Nichols because it was endorsed by Michael Atherton. A swashbuckling batsman, I was not. And my blade gives testimony of my lack of swash and buckle. There's no big red spot slap bang in the middle where I once hit the fastest bowler in Lancashire for a six over mid-wicket. No tape applied to keep the bat together because I had wielded it with such power over the years. Just several marks down the outside edge. Evidence of numerous prods and pushes that invariably ended up in the gloves of a wicketkeeper or the hands of a slip. This day would be different, though. Here I was in the summer of 2011, digging out the old bat and confident that at least today my power would come to the fore and I would crunch a few through the covers. Having recently moved to Northwest England, I'd been asked to go down to the nets of the local cricket club. With little else to do that day, the life of a sporting journalist isn't all go, 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 you know, it seemed like a fun way to spend the morning and a chance for me and my playing partner to check out some sporting facilities in the vicinity. I said that I'd drive us both down and so set about loading the car with our gear. In went my bat. I needed nothing more. 10 minutes later, after I had eventually managed to get his cricket bag, which is the size of a small wardrobe, a set of stumps, a change of clothes for after our session, two water bottles, a Powerade drink and a banana all into the boot. The banana didn't take up that much room, by the way, but it has to be included just to emphasise how much crap he needed with him compared to me. We were ready to go. It was damp, miserable and muggy as we set off to the club. It's always important when covering cricket to mention the weather conditions, especially when you're going to use them as an excuse for your performance later on. It was not a day to top up your tan, although in leafy Cheshire it is normally a woman wearing surgical gloves and working in a booth who tops up your tan rather than the weather. The rain was holding off as we pulled into the drive. I hadn't been here for 20 years and very little had changed. The drive was still a collection of sharp stones that could take out your tyre as easily as Michael Holding could an England batsman when I first started watching the sport. The pavilion might have had the odd lick of paint in the intervening years, but nothing else had been updated. The first team pitch under covers still had an untouchable air to it. I had never been good enough to get near it. As we parked behind the pavilion, the nets were located to the right. Only three of them, and they were all empty. In fact, the place was deserted, which struck me as quite sad at the time, but with hindsight, turned out to be a blessing in disguise. As we got out of the car, I started to regale my companion with tales of my cricketing youth. He was suitably indifferent. Plus, he was struggling to carry all his drinks, the banana, the stumps, and the small wardrobe over to the nets. I, on the other hand, was strolling over, twirling my cherished bat in my hand like a dandy, a 21st century sporting equivalent of Oscar Wilde. The club was obviously concerned about people burgling the nets or maybe setting up a tent and squatting there, so before we could do anything, we had to negotiate the padlock. Once my companion had entered the code, we were nearly ready to go. We picked a net, and I wandered down the astroturf to put up the stumps at the far end. It is always important when covering cricket to mention the surface of the wicket, especially when you're going to use it as an excuse later on. The stumps were spring-loaded and all attached to one metal plate. As I set them down, I looked back up the strip to see my playing partner going through a stretching routine and moving his left arm round and round in a circular motion. He's taking this seriously, I thought. He might not be seeing this as just a friendly knockabout in the nets. What do you want to do first, bat or bowl? Given he'd been doing a passable impression of a windmill for the past few minutes, I already knew the answer, but I thought it polite to give him the option. I'll bowl at you, came the less than surprising reply. I picked up my bat, turned on my heels and headed back towards the stumps. Do you want to stick a pad on? He asked. If you're unfamiliar with cricket, let me just explain the role of the pads. Given that a cricket ball is A, very hard, and B can be hurled in a batsman's direction at some speed, there are various bits of equipment available to the batsman for his protection. A helmet for the head, a box for the delicate areas, and pads for the shins and the knees. When having a gentle net, a batsman might choose to forego some or all of the equipment, and at the level we were playing at that morning, there was certainly no need for a helmet or a box. The most that might be required would be one pad to protect my front leg, i.e. the one that would be nearest the ball. Being a typical man, I decided I would be fine without. I wasn't going to get hurt here, I really wasn't. I was going to channel my inner Atherton. That had to be good enough. Even as I watched my opponent measure out his run-up, I didn't think about protection. He marked out 10 steps. I'll be fine. 11 steps. He isn't quick enough yet to hurt me. 12 steps. I haven't got time to go and get a pad now. 13 steps. Right, remember, channel Atherton. Channel Atherton. 14 steps. If in doubt, just jump out of the way. He stopped. Oh, thank Christ for that. He turned. Ready? He shouted. He had to shout because he appeared now to be a very, very long way away. A cricket pitch is 22 yards long and he must have been that plus another 15 yards away from me. Ready? I replied while thinking, I am going to show him just what it takes to get to my level. But just as pride comes before a fall, middle-aged bravado often comes before both mental and physical pain. He began his run-up. I gripped hard the trusty old grey nickels. The greatest talents have soft hands. Mine were so tense, the veins were bulging. I hadn't worn batting gloves either. I lifted the bat, I banged it into the astroturf next to my back foot. I lifted it once more as he got closer, my eyes focused on his run-up. I was waiting to see the left hand gripping the ball. If you look at the grip as a bowler is about to bowl, you can hopefully understand what he's going to try to do with the delivery. I saw the grip. I saw him begin the jump as he got ready to release the ball. I saw his right arm come out to try and give him some kind of accuracy. I saw the left arm get higher and higher. I saw him release the ball. Then, I didn't see the ball. I pushed forward to where I expected the ball to be, inner Atherton, if in doubt, a nice forward defensive will do. But I was too late. The ball had already careered off the pitch, grazed my knee and clattered into my stumps. If there was plenty wrong with my eyesight at that moment, there was nothing wrong with my hearing, as I clearly picked up the noise of a wicket reverberating on a coiled spring, mixed in with the cheering of the bowler. My head was down. I couldn't look up. I didn't want to acknowledge the delivery, give credit to the bowler, or even look him in the eye. What I really wanted to do was rub my knee because it bloody hurt, but I couldn't do that either because that would be a sign of weakness and also a sign of my own stupidity in not sticking a pad on in the first place. No, before I did anything, I just needed to gather my thoughts together, and that wasn't easy to do given the high-pitched mockery coming from the bowler. I've always found it quite hard to keep my temper in a sporting environment, but I had to remain calm here. I couldn't lose my rag because this was just meant to be a bit of fun. I also couldn't lose my rag because the bowler, dancing a jig and gloating in front of me, was my son. He was also 8 years old. Could I look up and blame my abject performance on the muggy conditions and the abject surface? No, I couldn't. Could I shatter his joy and elation by telling him he just got lucky and the ball might have hit a stray stone on the way through to me? No, I couldn't. Instead, I had to accept that I'd reached a truly horrific stage in my life, the moment the sporting parent dreads. Holding the bat that I loved, that I was proud of, that had been such a part of my sporting youth and yet looked like a relic to my boy, I had to stand there, mainly on one leg because my knee was throbbing, and admit that it was over. I was no longer better at sport than one of my children. I had just been bowled, all ends up, by my 8-year-old son. Things would never be the same again, and that might include my knee. Chapter 1. A comprehensive list of the great stadia in the world would be the subject of much debate and conjecture. It would probably depend on your choice of sport, your choice of team, and your experiences in said stadium. Cricket lovers might throw in Lord's or the Melbourne Cricket Ground. Rugby union fans could suggest the Millennium Stadium, perhaps, while the football goers could lob in Wembley. The football hipsters, after stroking their beards and straightening their skinny jeans, would probably opt for Borussia Dortmund's Westfalenstadion, with its wall of noise and sea of yellow and black. I, and there's every chance I may be alone in this suggestion, would like to throw in Haywood Road, Sale. Ramshackle wouldn't do the old place justice. There was just one area where you could sit with wooden chairs laid out. To refer to this section as a stand would be taking it too far. In the rest of the ground, you could just walk around and stand wherever you liked. Weeds protruded out of every nook and cranny, and encasing the whole of the pitch was a railing covered with chipped white paint and rust. At one end was a squash club, which actually made it way ahead of its time as a multi-purpose sport venue, because the main reason to go to Haywood Road was to watch rugby union, to watch Sale FC. They're now known as Sale Sharks after some marketing individual decided that they were prevalent in the canal that runs through the town. I held my 21st birthday party in the stadium's bar, and despite me somehow ending up with two ex-girlfriends giving daggers at each other all night, and the hastily booked DJ ending the night with "You'll Never Walk Alone," which never tends to go down well in a suburban Manchester bar, I have nothing but fond memories of the place. Before Sale was overrun with sharks, and before I would even notice girls, let alone have two exes, I used to go down to Haywood Road to watch the rugby union. For the casual adult fan, it can be quite a difficult sport to understand, so as a child not yet into double figures, I found it particularly confusing. The saving grace was that this was before the rugby union authorities kept coming up with new rules every year, so there was a lot less stop-starting than there is now. To the untrained eye of my 9-year-old self, it simply looked like 30 men trying to whack the crap out of each other with the occasional bit of skill thrown in. This was also the era before groundsmen were invented, so there was very little grass in evidence, which meant that not long into each match, it looked like 30 men all dressed the same, trying to whack the crap out of each other, with the occasional bit of skill thrown in. I was always dressed the same as well. Rain or shine, hot or cold, my mum would send me wrapped in a cagoule. Every time I went, I always had the same thing to eat, too, a packet of salt and vinegar crisps. I used to place them in the pouch in the front of the cagoule, very much in the same way a kangaroo takes care of its young. It meant that I and the cagoule always stank of salt and vinegar crisps, and means that even to this day, whenever I open a packet of them and inhale the vinegar fumes, it takes me back to the 1980s and Haywood Road. The other constant in my trips to Haywood Road was my dad. There was always sport to be watched, and if Dad and I weren't going to the football, then we'd go to the rugby. Into the brown Sirocco we would jump, and 5 minutes later, on account that we lived quite close and not because my dad was speeding, we were parking up and walking into Haywood Road. There wasn't a ticketing system as such. My dad would pay on the gate and a man would hand over 2 raffle tickets as proof of payment. They were never checked and there was never a raffle prize to be won. As I walked past the ticket man, there would be a welcoming nod, while at the same time I could see in his eyes that he was thinking, why has he got a cagoule on? It's a warm April day. And while we're at it, where's that strong smell of salt and vinegar coming from? We never sat in the stand. You didn't sit at rugby union games. It was all about standing, all men together, drinking beer. Although not me and my dad. He was driving and I was 9. We always stood in the same place, on the far corner of the ground opposite the entrance we came through. Sometimes I would lean against the railing, sometimes I would stand on the moss-covered concrete banks, ramped up behind the railing. That was as daring and as impulsive as it got, because to describe the Sale crowd as creatures of habit would be a gross understatement. Men would stand in the same place every game. They would drink the same beer every game. And to my young ear, they would shout the same things every game. We were always in the proximity of one man at Haywood Road, dressed in a grey anorak with a flat cap protecting his bald pate from the elements. He always stood in the same spot and looked like the kind of old man us Sale youths would be encouraged to help across the road to prove we weren't young hoodlums terrorising the neighbourhood. Until he opened his mouth, that is, because this was no frail old man. This was an old man who was going to stand in the same place at Sale every week and bollock every single player in blue and white, no matter who they were or who the opposition were. Rugby union wasn't professional in those days. There was one cup competition, but aside from that, every match was meant to be a friendly. A succession of northern teams would roll, literally, in the case of the physique of some of the players, into Sale. Oral, Fylde, Broughton Park were often the opponents. Occasionally, we'd get a bit of exotic glamour when a team from a far-flung foreign land would arrive, such as Neath or Boroughmuir. And then, very occasionally, we'd get one of the big boys, such as Leicester. But the opponents were irrelevant to this old man. Sale needed criticising, and he was the man to do it. And he was going to do it in a booming voice that you could hear on the opposite side of the ground. "Mallander, you're rubbish," he would cry. Mallander was Jim Mallander, the Sale fullback, a man who now coaches the rather successful Premiership side, Northampton Saints. "Smith, you can't pass it! You can't pass it, Smith!" He was keen to reiterate his point, but when he said it the second time, he just cleverly switched the order of the words for a bit of variety. And I'm not sure Smith, who was Steve Smith, the England scrum half, ever really appreciated the subtlety. "Stansfield, you're a big girl's blouse. A big girl's blouse, that's what you are, Stansfield." Stansfield was his favourite target. I don't think he thought he was particularly tough. He may not have been particularly correct, but this old man never swore. He was loud and he was critical, but he wasn't foul-mouthed, so my dad was never concerned about standing near him. He amused us. He made us laugh and roll our eyes. But after several games at Sale, I wanted to know from my dad just what he was on about. Why is Mallander rubbish? Why can't Smith pass? And what is a big girl's blouse? As I asked my dad these questions in the car on the way home, and my dad gave his answers and put them into context, it dawned on me. This man next to me, I was allowed in the front seat for a short journey, this man approaching 40, that was very old in my world, this man who goes out to work in a suit, this man who drives me around, this man who shouts at me and my sister whenever we are naughty, this man who does a lot of DIY and gardening, this man who does all of that, once used to be a sportsman. He actually used to play the game that we were watching. My eyes started to sting with tears that were forming. My breath had been taken away. This man was now a sporting superstar. He was no longer sat in a brown middle-market German car. He was bathed in the light of glory. My dad was a sportsman. He was a rugby player, not an architect. He would be the best dad in the playground. He would be able to shimmy and shuffle and score glorious tries against all of them. He was my hero. That is the paragraph I would write if I'd been granted poetic license for this book, but I haven't. In reality, I did what every small boy does when they discover that their father has participated in some kind of sporting activity. I looked at him. I then looked him up and down, my young eyes drawn to the start of a middle-aged spread, and said, "Really? You used to play rugby? You used to play that game that we've been watching at Sale? How could my old dad do some of the things that Smith, Mallander and Stansfield were doing when he couldn't even stop me going past him and scoring a try in the garden? That surely wasn't possible. He couldn't catch me or tackle me, so he wouldn't be able to do that in a proper game, would he? The only person I'd ever seen him tackle was my mum, in a family game in the garden. And to be fair to my dad, that had been a textbook tackle. That had probably been a clue that he'd been a decent player, maybe still was, but at the moment it happened, I didn't have time to think about it properly because he'd tackled her with rather too much verve and vigour and the two of them had crashed through the fence into next door's garden. It was difficult to praise my dad as my mum tried to extricate herself from next door's shrubbery while at the same time threatening him with divorce. Chapter 2. For the first Saturday in April, it was a surprisingly warm morning. Cars and ambulances routinely trundled past on my left, but I barely noticed them. The sun was shining through thin trails of wispy clouds, and I perched on a bench and basked in its glow. I was also basking in the glow of becoming a father. Sitting there with my phone in hand, I was texting and telling as many people as possible that I was a dad. This was mainly through pride. I had a son and I wanted the world to know. But also because I wanted to get back into the hospital to check mother and baby were okay and then get home in time for Manchester United against Liverpool in the lunchtime kickoff. The game would come later. Sitting on that bench on the 5th of April 2003, I couldn't stop smiling. I had a son. I had a son. I had a son! We hadn't found out the sex of the baby before the birth, and whenever we had been asked, we had always said the right thing. We don't mind whether it's a boy or a girl as long as it's healthy. And that was true. But when he popped out, well, was pulled out with a plunger attached to his head because he was awkward, it's probably more an accurate description, I was overjoyed. I kept thinking, sport, sport, sport. On that bench in the sun, inhaling the passing traffic fumes, all the fun we were going to have raced through my mind. I'd be taking my son to games just like my dad did with me. We'd be kicking balls about in the garden. I'd be teaching him how to hold a bat, putting on his armbands for the first time, showing him how to score in cricket, throw, catch, run and jump. We'd grow together in a specially built man cave that would always have sport on the television and sporting games on the PlayStation. nappies, feeds and sleepless nights hadn't even come into the equation by this stage. It was going to be all fun and no hard work. And before we go any further, I do realise I could have had exactly the same feelings if I had had a baby girl. And indeed, my first daughter has proved to me that all those things I dreamt about doing and have done with her brother, she is determined to do too. She will not be left out, and quite right too. But back in the spring of 2003, I was just excited to know I would now have a lifetime of father and son bonding ahead of me. We didn't get off to a good start. Ben was 3 weeks old when we settled down to watch our first match together. A momentous occasion for a father, less so for the child as they'll never ever remember it. Even though there were just the two of us watching, I wanted to make sure he looked the part. So he had on his Manchester United baby grow as we settled down to watch United's game at Spurs. United were in a race for the title with Arsenal, and there were only 3 games left in the season. It was tense, it was scrappy, and there was little enjoyment to be had. The game wasn't much better. I couldn't get Ben to settle. He was restless, uncomfortable, and cried a lot. We sat on the sofa, we walked around the room, we got close to the TV, we moved away from the TV, we went into a carry cot, we went out of the carry cot, we went out into the garden, although not too far, because I still needed to see the screen. Midway through the second half, we got comfy on a beanbag. United were 1-0 up and just needed to see the game out, and they would be ever closer to another Premier League title. With my wife asleep upstairs, and my son now asleep in my arms, United would hopefully be as serene as my current environment as they approach the final whistle. Time fades the memory, so I can't actually remember whether the last 15 minutes or so were nerve-wracking or not. But in the 90th minute, Ruud van Nistelrooy grabbed a second for United. Everything that happened next, though, is still fresh in the mind despite the passing of the years. As the ball hit the back of the net, I cheered loudly, forgetting momentarily I had a sleeping baby in my arms. I also jumped up off the beanbag, again oblivious to the sleeping child. As I did, my foot slipped and the sleeping child went up into the air. Recalling my days fielding at gully, one of the closer in fielding positions in cricket where you need lightning-ish quick reactions, I didn't panic and calmly waited for Ben to land back in my arms, which he duly did, and we watched the end of the game. Or maybe not. In reality, I flailed around, panicking that I was just about to drop my newly born son. I stumbled and slipped. My foot rammed hard into the skybox, the television wobbled on its glass stand, and as the screen went black and I struggled to balance, I managed to grab onto Ben and prevent him crashing onto the floor. I now had a crying baby, a wife pelting down the stairs, a sore foot, and a skybox that wasn't working. Perhaps unsurprisingly, an argument followed. I put it down to us all being tired and emotional with a new baby in the house, as opposed to it being caused by my general lack of coordination, combined with actually forgetting I was holding my son. The argument spread to my mum and dad's house, 200 miles away in Manchester. With Sky not working, a modern-day disaster for any sports fan, I needed to find out if United had held on for the win. The phone conversation went as follows. Dad. 5389. Never hello. Always the last 4 digits of the phone number. I think it's a generational thing. Me. It's me. Dad. Hi, me. Me. All okay? Dad. All okay. All okay there? Me. All okay here. Now, at this point, Mum picks up another phone to join in the scintillating chat. Mum. Hello, how's Ben? Is he okay? How's Sarah? How are you? Me. We're all fine. Dad, did United win? Dad. Yep, 2-0. Were you not watching? Me. We were watching, and I saw the Van Nistelrooy goal, but in celebrating it, I jumped off the beanbag, slipped, nearly dropped Ben, but caught him, and in the process put my foot through the skybox so the TV went black, and I missed the end of the game, so I didn't know whether it had stayed 2-0 or not. Dad. So is the skybox okay? Mum. Jim! The perception of friends and colleagues is that, as I work in sport, I must have rammed it down my kids' throats from an early age. The opposite has been the case, partly because I learnt from the previous incident that watching sport with a small child can be a dangerous business, and partly because if you force something on a child, they tend to rebel against it. We decided early on that although we would love all our children to embrace sport and its qualities, they had to discover it for themselves. Sport was more often than not on the television or on the radio, but they wouldn't be made to watch it or listen to it with me. And anyway, the beanbag had been declared out of bounds by Sarah for all future sporting activity. There would always be balls around the house and in the garden, mainly because I wanted to play with them, but I would never demand that Ben kick or throw a ball with me. If he was going to, I was adamant that it would be because he wanted to. I fought some quite strong urges to get him to kick a ball with me or play catch with me, not because I wanted a playmate or some father-son time, but because I do believe that if you can throw, catch and kick a ball, then as a boy, your school days will be a damn sight easier. Rightly or wrongly, if you can join in those playground games or be part of a team to even a basic standard, there will be less chance of you feeling like an outsider. Less chance, to put it bluntly, of being bullied. I did make him sit near me when Johnny Wilkinson dropped that goal. It seemed important, despite him being only 6 months old. But more often than not, balls were pushed to one side and sport on the small screen in the corner was blissfully ignored. When Thomas the Tank Engine came on, however, he was slap bang in front of it, cajoling me to build him another track. Art, physics and craft design and technology were not my strong points at school, and yet my small son was now expecting me to combine them all together on a daily basis while trying to avoid the shattering pain of kneeling on a Percy or a Gordon. Practice never made perfect, but practice did mean I evolved in time from a rectangular track to a figure of eight. My track-building inadequacy was highlighted whenever my architect father arrived and proceeded to engineer something that wouldn't have looked out of place in a window display at Hamley's. A walk with Ben to one of the local parks would take us out onto the main road and over a local bridge, under which ran both tube and overground lines. There was an eagerness on Ben's behalf on the way to the park, as he knew that swings and slides and roundabouts awaited. If we timed it right at the weekend, there'd also be a chance of catching a local amateur game of football or cricket. I just can't walk past a game going on in a park. I have to stop and watch, even if it's just for a short while. However, there was little interest from my son. There was impatience. He didn't want to stop and watch amateur sport. He wanted to get back to the bridge to watch the choo-choos. We must have spent hours on that bridge, right by a main roundabout, breathing in toxic fumes, watching train after train after train glide by. Ben would be sitting in his buggy, snuggled up in a big blanket and bobble hat, waving profusely at every driver, while I would be bent down next to him, wondering if my knees had locked in the cold and if I was permanently stuck on my haunches. After much creaking and groaning from my knees, not the tracks down below, we would walk back home, Ben happy and content, me wondering if I was doomed to a good few years train spotting with my son instead of a lifetime of sporting adventures. But then something changed. It would be lovely for the purposes of this book if it was one romantic moment that a bulb came on in his head and he saw the sporting light. If one day he picked up a ball and it glowed mesmerically as he held it in outstretched arms with the palms of chunky little hands upturned. That classical music played in the background as he realised the power and the beauty that such a simple object could bring to his everyday life. That this one thing could be thrown or kicked, caught or headed, served or smashed, lobbed or dropped, and that because of it, he would experience the full gamut of emotions. And that through being involved with this one object, this one beautiful ball, he would discover friends for life and create memories that would last forever. In reality, he probably picked up an old tennis ball, held it high above his head, wobbled unsteadily as he tried to throw it, let it go, and it bounced, rolled and trundled until it got stuck under the settee. This meant that I had to scrabble around in the dust and the crumbs under the settee, no point cleaning what you never see, with my backside in the air to get the ball back. And as any small child will tell you, putting your parents in an uncomfortable situation is a hilarious game and much more fun than getting them to build a train track. So Ben wanted to do it again and again and again. It is highly probable that the make daddy fetch the ball game turned him off trains and onto balls. He was hooked. Thomas and Percy were forever parked in his little train carrying case and balls were everywhere. At every opportunity, he wanted to be in a garden or to be in the park. No longer did he want to stand on a bridge or a roundabout watching trains chug by. I found it exhilarating to watch this little person who I'd helped to create exhibit such a delight in sport and balls. I found it strangely emotional. If I was being completely honest, there was a sense of relief as well, because, as I explained earlier, I thought if I could get him to throw, catch and kick properly, then hopefully his school days would be a lot easier. That was a big if, and also a big responsibility. Could I teach him the required ball skills? Those early sporting years with any small child require an inordinate amount of patience and also an unerring ability to put all your own instincts to one side and be unbelievably bad at all you are doing. I have had to carefully stage manage any race, any game, any contest to make sure that in those early years my children always won. I am one of the slowest individuals ever put on this earth, and yet even I could beat all three of my children in a race up and down the garden when they were toddling. So as every parent will know, you need to develop your own technique that eventually enables this unsteady bundle of joy, energy and determination to beat you. I ended up developing a slow motion running technique. And yes, I know if you have actually been on a sports team with me, you will say that it was my normal running technique, but I was actually going even slower than that. Putting one limb in front of another would take at least 5 seconds to allow my opponent to get his chubby little legs ahead of mine. I imagined looking like a gallant runner in an epic film reaching for the line to claim glory, whereas in reality I probably resembled one of the lovers you see running down a beach into each other's arms in a cheesy rom-com. Of course, small children are unsteady on their feet at the best of times, so most races would involve one of them stumbling, at which point I'd be left with a dilemma. Do I race past them and claim glory? The answer would always be no. But there is only so far you can take slow motion running, and if I ended up going any slower, I would be standing still. I couldn't do that, as there would be a chance that as they picked themselves up, they would recognise I was letting them win. The only thing to do when they fall is for you to fall yourself. The number of surprisingly tough daisies, dandelions and weeds I've tripped over is into the hundreds. And so, while I'm picking myself up and admonishing the offending small flower loudly for the benefit of my opponent, my child is running around celebrating winning the race. And I am happy, because we are having fun. I witness the joy and the elation on a small, ruddy face. I see the delight in them realising they've achieved something in victory. I feel the warmth of family life and drink in the laughter and screams and whoops in the garden and tell myself to remember these moments because they won't be small forever. And yet, all the while, I'm also thinking, bugger, I've just been beaten by a 3-year-old. Ben and I would spend hours both outside and inside playing a variety of sports. There wasn't just one thing he wanted to do. He was soaking up a variety of ball games and was keen to try them all. Football was prominent, but cricket, tennis and rugby were all on his little agenda as well. In those early years, I found football the easiest to play with him. It was all very simple. I passed the ball to him. He passed the ball back. Eventually. It became slightly harder when he wanted to practice shooting. The power isn't quite there in a 3 or 4 year old, which means as the goalkeeper, you have to develop ingenious ways of letting the ball go in. I say ingenious, in reality, of course, I just mean falling over in a semi-comical, semi-realistic way. I became a combination of Norman Wisdom and Massimo Taibbi. The ball would regularly go through my legs. I'd have to dive over it using my speciality slow motion technique, or I would rush out but miss both the ball and, more importantly, him, and allow him a free run on goal. As the skills built up and the confidence and love for the game grew, in Ben, not me, we reached the point where he would want a game. This would need careful stage managing. Our garden wasn't particularly big, but big enough for a father v 4-year-old son football match. At the far end of the garden, next to a small shed, we had a proper goal. Two nets would have felt extravagant and unnecessary, so the other goal, the one nearest to the house, consisted of a bucket and a ride-on-sized Thomas the Tank Engine. Not so much jumpers for goalposts, more children's tat for goalposts. Ben would always want to shoot towards the proper net, as it was much more exciting for him to see the ball nestle in a proper net when he scored than it was to see it bounce off Thomas's plastic funnel and land by some wooden decking. The only negative in our arrangement was that it left me shooting towards the house and therefore shooting towards the windows. They shouldn't be in danger, though, unless I ever chose to thump a shot, but in a game with a 4-year-old, there shouldn't ever be a reason to thump a shot, should there? We would play first to 5 or first to 10. Ben would always win, of course, but it'd be close, always 5-4 or 10-9. He had to know that he had been in a battle with his old man. Watching him develop was another benefit of being a dad. He would try things he'd seen on television, even at this early age. Dragbacks, stepovers, nutmegs. They rarely worked. Why would they? They hadn't worked for me for over 30 years, so it was highly unlikely he'd nail them after only 4. I allowed him the odd nutmeg, where a player puts the ball through the legs of an opponent and runs around him to take the ball, and resisted the urge to clatter him as he did it. The goals would be accompanied by celebrations, little dances, attempted cartwheels, shirts over the head with belly proudly on display. Ben would also sometimes celebrate his goals. As fun as these games are, you have to remind yourself so many times in the course of them that you are taking on a 4-year-old. Years of flying into tackles, hitting a ball as hard as possible and winning headers have to be forgotten. I had to allow myself to be tackled so that Ben could get the ball back, sometimes painfully, as tackling hadn't really been on our radar and his technique was just to swing his leg and see what he could connect with. Ankle, shin, knee, ball, they were all the same to him. The old school defenders of the 70s and 80s would have looked on in admiration. If I went so near as to tackle him, he would roll around on the grass, part screaming, part giggling. Children definitely copy what they see on television. Occasionally, the self-control would slip, and I just wouldn't be able to resist the urge to let fly at goal. There were times in our garden, and I'm not proud of this, when a small boy would stand still as a ball not only flew past his head, but also hurtled towards the patio doors. Fortunately, nothing was ever broken, neither part of my son nor part of the house. I know I'm not alone in my temporary enthusiasm to let fly. A friend of mine was in his garden playing cricket. His son was batting, and after a good half hour of feeding balls for him to whack and then having to fetch them, my friend was resisting hard the urge to raise the game a notch or two. He continued, however, with his underarm throws, and his son continued putting bat on ball, and in the manner of a golden retriever in the park, my friend kept fetching the ball back. After a few more minutes of this monotony, he had had enough and wanted to do something different. "I decided to give him a bit of chin music," he told me. Now, chin music is a term that refers to bowling a ball shorter than normal so that it rears up off the ground and by the time it reaches the batsman is somewhere around head height, or I suppose chin height. Some of the best cricket footage around is of legendary fast bowlers tormenting some of the world's best batsmen with fast, short bowling. Batsmen ducking, diving and jumping around to avoid being hit by deliveries that could be coming at them at speeds of around 90 miles an hour. Bowlers throughout the years, from Truman to Ambrose, Holding to Donald, Lilly to Wasim Akram, have used it as a weapon of fear and intimidation, and it has been witnessed at all the great cricketing venues of the world. It has not often, to my knowledge, been witnessed in a suburban garden in Middlesex. Undeterred by the fact that the short ball is a weapon of fear and intimidation, and knowing that he wouldn't be getting up to speeds of 90 miles an hour on account of middle age, my friend wound up his trusty right arm and sent a tennis ball down his garden and past his son's ear. Startled, and probably thinking that the ball had just slipped out or that his dad was just messing about, his son turned around, went to pick up the ball, and throw it back to his dad. With the ball back in his hand, you might have expected my friend to have got his fit of pique out of his system. But no, he repeated the delivery. Again, the ball whizzed past his son. Again, it was retrieved. My friend now reverted to his underarm deliveries and allowed his son to hit the ball. He'll have to learn, he said, while recounting this episode to me. It won't be underarm throws throughout his cricketing life. Absolutely not, I agreed. Although, it probably will be for the next couple of years. He is only six, after all. Never too early to introduce him to it, though, he added, unconvincingly, trying to justify bouncing his small child. And while he stuck to that point, he decided to throw a couple of bouncers in there for a couple of other reasons, in my opinion. The first was to show his son that he could play cricket properly, and that he wasn't just there to throw and fetch a ball for his son's benefit, and that in some way he would gain his son's admiration for being able to bowl a proper bouncer at him. The fact that, at that stage, this small boy had no idea what a bouncer was until that ball whistled past him, and that most people show no admiration for a person aiming the ball at the head, however old, let alone six, was lost on him. Playing bat and ball with small children would test the patience of a saint. I've tried cricket, tennis and racquetball with my brood, and all can be very, very hard work in the early days. Once again, it comes down to coordination. Unless your offspring is Tiger Woods, who is driving golf balls with power and accuracy from the age of two, you have to accept that more often than not, your child is going to be unable to put bat on ball. Ben and I spent hours in the garden and on beaches on holiday with me gently throwing a tennis ball at him, him wielding a small bat, swinging in the vague direction of it, and then watching as it trickled past him with no connection made. He has given me thousands of looks to suggest it was my fault for not bowling it properly. He would, of course, expect me to fetch it, and on the odd occasion he would do his own dirty work. The throw back to me would be so inaccurate that more often than not I'd be spending a good 5 minutes trying to extricate the ball from a particularly thick bush. My main memory of those early days of playing cricket with him is of having a bad back through constantly bending down to pick the ball up or having to stretch into the undergrowth to retrieve it. Tennis is even worse. Whilst playing that with either my son or my older daughter, the one word in the tennis lexicon that we've never had recourse to use was rally. Hitting the ball to each other was non-existent. The general pattern would be as follows. I would hit a ball over the net. Ben would run in, have a swipe, and miss. I'd hit another ball over the net. Jesse would run in, swipe, connect with the ball with the frame of the racket, and watch as it ballooned out of the court. And when I say out of the court, I mean over the fence for guess who to go and fetch it back. I would always try to have at least three tennis balls in each pocket as if I had some peculiar medical condition growing out of both thighs. I'd hit another ball into the net. Another way over my head. Another missed. And so on and so on. I'd then go and gather them all up while the kids would run around, do cartwheels, pick their nose, basically anything to avoid the dirty work. Those early sporting years are a slog, a test of patience and a test of your back, but all that pales into insignificance as you watch your children fall in love with sport. They develop before your very eyes. Fewer balls are missed by a bat. Shots that you hit a bit harder are stopped by their little hands. You don't have to trip over that concrete dandelion quite so often. There is laughter and there are tears. There are cuddles and high fives and tantrums. There are walks back from the park caked in mud and soaked to the skin. Hot chocolates to warm them up in winter. Cold beers.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.